The story of the Salvation Deity is one of the oldest myths in recorded history of mankind. Prior to the emergence of the Christ myth, there was hardly a god in four continents who had not been born of a virgin, persecuted by wicked rulers, condemned to death, and sacrificed for the benefit of his followers. The melodramatic rise and fall of the Savior God was essentially the same throughout the ancient world. A lowly human creature is elevated to the level of a deity. He is then dragged down to the lowest depths of humiliation and degradation. Finally, he was executed so that he can come to life again and offer forgiveness and salvation to the very people who denounced him. Among the inhabitants of that vast and terrifying world inundated with mythology, it was common knowledge that a man who symbolized a god always had to be killed. "Men create gods," said Anthocles, "and then destroy them." And the scenario was always the same. The god pretender will be despised and rejected. For the sins of the people, he will be stricken. He will bear their grief and carry their sorrow. He will be wounded, and those who see him will find no beauty in him. He will be dressed in purple. A mock crown of thorns will be put on his head and a mock scepter in his hands. He will be scourged and crucified. Above his head they will put a derisive sign, and he will live forever in myth. To pave the way for a more complete understanding of how the mythologically rooted Christian faith was created, consider for a moment the fabrication of a less complicated scenario, the Apostles' Creed. An obvious forgery exposed long ago by a scholarly gentleman named Lorenzo Balla. If we substitute the name Dionysus or Krishna or Hercules or Osiris or Attis for the name of Jesus, and instead of Mary insert the name of Samael, Devaki, Alcmene, or Neith, or Nana, and for Pontius Pilate use the name of any terrestrial tyrant who comes into the story, and we will have a creed that fits in all particulars into the rites and worship of any of the savior gods of the Orient and beyond. The Gentile theologians who came to be known as Catholics created, developed, and refined a counterfeit Christ at the expense of both the Jewish faith and the original form of Christianity, which was Gnostic to the core. They grafted onto the Gnostic myth of Jesus the incredibly complex layers of orthodoxy that would eventually result in the establishment of an oppressive theocracy. It was only logical that Gentile theologians would concern themselves with shaping their new faith after the pattern of the salvation cults so popular at the time. Could the masses be induced to believe in the validity of a god on the esoteric basis of faith and love alone? No. But convince them that the god had been born of a virgin, had walked on water, and had even ascended from the grave, and the new god cult might have a chance to succeed. Catholic Christianity began with the trappings of just another salvation cult. To create a faith with greater common appeal, the Church's doctors of theology rearranged the patterns of fear, tradition, superstition, and motivation, while drawing miraculous and prophetic support for the new faith from the sacred writings of the Jews. By the end of the 4th century, at the latest, Catholicism had bloomed into a full-fledged mystery religion, offering salvation, more exclusive claims than its competitors, the promise of immortality for repentance in the form of fasting and a little memorized prayer, and shortcuts to a heavenly kingdom through baptism, the Eucharist, extreme unction, and other sacraments so magical and powerful that they could change human nature, or so the simple faithful believed. Through the sacraments, they could be born again and become the children of the eternal and unchangeable God instead of the children of mortal men.